Hi everyone, this is Jaspal, and in this video I'll be presenting our paper titled Large Message Homomorphic Secret Sharing and Applications. This is a joint work with Lance Roy at Oregon State University. The talk would be structured as follows. I'll begin by introducing the notion of homomorphic secret sharing, also abbreviated as HSS, and its traditional security definition, followed by a summary of all known results for two-party HSS from the research literature. Next, I'll present a general framework for the design of HSS protocols, and following which we'll essentially give our own proposed HSS construction. And finally, before concluding, I'll present a couple new applications for our HSS construction. Let's begin by the introduction. Traditional definition of HSS consists of three algorithms, share, eval, and decode. The share function is used to secret share the input X with the two evaluating parties. The evaluating parties run the eval algorithm, which takes as input a share of X and the program description P. The output of eval can be fed into the decode function, which outputs P of X, which is the evaluation of the program P on the original input X. Security of HSS requires two requirements to be met. One is correctness and secondly privacy. Correctness ensures that the decode output is correct, while privacy requirement states that each share XI should hide X. HSS can also be seen as the two-party relaxed variant of FHE, or fully homomorphic encryption, where servers can homomorphically compute on the secret input X under the additional constraint that the servers are non-colluding. We will specifically be looking at 1-P HSS constructions, where the correctness is allowed to fail with some probability P. Another interesting variant of HSS is the one where the decode function is a simple addition operation. We call such a construction HSS with additive decoding. This simplistic decode function opens up a large number of applications in crypto where HSS could be a viable solution. Including our work, most research literature on HSS has focused on the restricted multiplication programs as the model of computation, also known as the RMS model of computation. These programs allow for initialization of a certain number of memory values, where each memory value is bounded above by a parameter m, and it allows for the following operations. So we could initialize any memory value by a constant 1. We could output any memory value, which would essentially be part of the output of the RMS program. We could add any two memory values into another memory value. We could multiply any memory value by a public constant. And finally, we could do a restricted multiplication, which essentially means that you can multiply any input X with a memory value Y, to store that as a memory value Z. Due to the restricted multiplication, this model of computation certainly does not capture general circuits, yet this computation model is pretty expressive since it does capture branching programs and locked-up circuits at least. In this section, I'll present the known research literature on the problem of homomorphic secret sharing for the RMS model of computation. In 2016, Boyle, Gilboa, and Ishai initiated the line of work on secure computation from HSS with a construction based on decisional Diffie-Hellman assumption. On the timeline on this slide, below each work is mentioned the time complexity of running the RMS program using the given HSS scheme. Here, n represents the number of steps in the RMS program, m is the bound, and p is the net error probability. Note that the security parameter is treated as a constant and hence not reported when presenting these complexities. For PGA16, the running time is order mn squared by p, hence m has to be polycized and p has to be an inverse polynomial. In a follow-up work by Fazio et al., they construct a similar HSS scheme based on pi-A encryption, which is based on the decisional composite reciprocity assumption. They achieve the same complexity as BGA16. In a work due to Denier, Keller, and Klein in the following year, they improve the asymptotic complexity of the DTH-based HSS construction due to BGA16. They reduce the running time of the program to square root m by p into n raised to the power 3 by 2. Note that this still only gives us an inverse poly error and poly-sized message form. These limitations were finally removed by a work due to Boyle, Cole, and Shor, which uses lattice-based cryptography. Their scheme is based on the LWE problem and achieves homomorphic secret sharing with exponentially small correctness error and exponentially large message space. The running time of their protocol can be estimated to be order n times log square m by p, hence m can be exponential in the security parameter and p can be negligible as well. In this work, we introduce a new HSS construction based on Damodar's Urey crypto system, which is based on the DCR assumption as well. Our HSS construction manages to achieve negligible error probability and exponentially large message spaces without relying on stronger lattice-based assumptions. Furthermore, unlike all the previous works, we do not need any circular secure encryption scheme or any circular security assumptions. We also present two new applications of our HSS construction, which include a two-server constant bandwidth malicious secure ORA and a trapdoor hash function. A concurrent work due to Orlandi, Scholl, and Yakubov also proposed an HSS with negligible error probability for exponentially large message space. There are two versions of the protocol. One requires a circular security assumption, and the other uses a circular secure encryption scheme, like the Prakashsky-Goldwasser encryption scheme. PyA has a smaller plain text size limit than Damaka-Zurich. This forces them to chunk the input into smaller pieces, and they need to chunk in at least 6 ciphertexts for their scheme to work. Prakashsky-Goldwasser depends on breaking the key into bits, and they end up with one chunk per L bits in the key. However, we only need a single ciphertext to encode the input to the circuit. Hence, our HSS shares are either a constant factor or a theta of L times shorter than theirs. Next, we present a general framework for HSS constructions that encompasses all the HSS constructions from the literature, including ours. HSS is based on the interplay between two homomorphic schemes, an additively homomorphic encryption scheme and an additively secret sharing scheme. Encryption is represented by square brackets. It holds the inputs to the HSS program. Hence, the share function on input X outputs the encryption of X to both evaluating parties. Since the encryption scheme is homomorphic, given ciphertext of X and Y, we can generate ciphertext which decrypts to X plus Y and to C into X, where C is any constant. The additive shares are used to represent the register or memory values of the RMS program. We see a value Y stored in the program if the parties have additive shares of Phi times Y, where Phi is the private key of the encryption scheme. Although Phi times Y is the difference of the shares of the two parties, it's conventional to call them additive shares instead of subtractive shares because they are additively homomorphic. Similar to the encryption encoding, given additive shares of Phi times X and Phi times Y, we can get additive shares of Phi times X plus Y and Phi times C times Y, where C is a constant. There are of course multiple encryptions or sharings of the same value. So equality here essentially means that they represent the same value. They don't need to be exactly the same ciphertext or shares. We will next look at how an HSS scheme evaluates each RMS operation given the encodings that we defined on the previous slide. To initialize a memory value with 1, the servers use additive shares of the private key Phi, which was given to them as the output of the share function. To output a value X, the decode functions can subtract the additive shares of Phi times X and divide it by the private key Phi to obtain X. Addition of memory values and multiplication by a constant follow directly from the properties of the additive shares. Hence, the key challenge that remains is in how to perform a restricted multiplication, that is, multiply an input X with a memory value Y. The essential difference between different HSS protocols is in how they compute the RMS multiplication operation. Next, we discuss a high-level approach for how RMS multiplication is carried out in all HSS constructions. This is where the two homomorphic schemes interact. Each party locally raises the encryption of X to their additive shares of Y. By the properties of the encryption scheme, parties hence end up with multiplicative shares of the encryption of XY raised to Phi. That is, there is some kind of a bilinear mapping between additive secret shares and additively homomorphic encryption. Here we define the multiplicative share of Z to be elements Z1 and Z0 held by the two parties, such that Z is Z1 by Z0. Hence, the challenge of an RMS multiplication now reduces to converting multiplicative shares of the encryption of X times Y raised to Phi into additive shares of Phi times XY. Now note that the decryption algorithm for most additively homomorphic encryption schemes involves exponentiation by private key. For example, for PyA, when we raise the ciphertext of Z to the private key Phi, it outputs Psi of Phi Z, where Psi is a homomorphism from the plaintext space to the ciphertext space defined as Psi of Z is equal to 1 plus NZ. And for Elgamal, the homomorphism Psi would be defined as Psi of Z is equal to 1 comma G to the Z. From the homomorphism property of the encryption scheme, you also have that psi must be homomorphic, that is psi of u times psi of v will be equal to psi of u plus v, and psi of u raised to the power c would give us psi of c times u for any constant c. Note that in the challenge problem, we have the ciphertext of x into y raised to the power phi, which is the first step in the decryption process. Therefore, we just need to do the second decryption step, which is inverting the homomorphism psi, but on the multiplicative shares. Hence, the challenge problem is now to convert the multiplicative shares of psi of phi xy into additive shares of phi xy. Convert these multiplicative shares into additive shares, we use what's called a distance function that satisfies the following property. Distance of C times psi of Z minus distance of C should be equal to Z with probability at least 1 minus epsilon, where C is any ciphertext and Z is any plaintext. Given a distance function satisfying this property, we can make the two evaluating parties compute the distance function on their respective multiplicative shares of psi of phi xy. Now note that by the definition of the distance function, the difference between the outputs of the distance functions is exactly equal to phi times xy. This describes the complete process for how an RMS multiplication can be carried out. All HSS schemes differ precisely in how the distance function is computed, and it's the epsilon error in the correctness of the distance function that is the cause of the error in the correctness of the HSS scheme as well. Next, I'll present our proposed distance function, which has negligible error probability for pi A and Damocard-Zurich ciphertext. Next, we have our main construction. In our HSS construction, we use the Damocard-Zurich public key cryptosystem to encrypt the input values. This cryptosystem is based on a homomorphism exp from the addition of plaintext to multiplication of ciphertext and on its inverse function log. These functions are analogous to e raised to power nx and log base e raised to power n, but exp is defined modulo n to the s plus 1 and log is defined modulo n to the s. Power series in nx can have at max s non-zero terms modulo n to the s, because the power of s term will be a multiple of n to the s. Hence, the Taylor series for log and exp become finite sums. Using the finite sums, it can be proven that exp and log are inverse functions of each other and are homomorphisms. This is analogous to how properties of e to the x and natural log of x over the real numbers can be proven using the Taylor series. These homomorphisms are then used to define the Damocard-Zurich homomorphic encryption scheme. The keychain algorithm takes as input the security parameter kappa, then samples two primes p and q and outputs the public key n equals p times q and the private key phi equals p minus 1 times q minus 1, which is the output of the Euler-Totient function on input n. The size of the primes p and q is chosen so as to ensure that the cryptosystem has kappa bits of security. The encrypt function applies the homomorphism exp on the input x and then hides the plaintext by multiplying it by r raised to the power ns, which is the random perfect power of n to the s. The decrypt function exponentiates the ciphertext with the private key to cancel out r raised to the power ns, and then it applies the log function, which is the inverse of the exp function. Finally, the output of the log is divided by phi to extract the plaintext. To prove correctness of this cryptosystem, we note that the Euler's theorem exponentiates the ciphertext of x by phi, removing the randomness, leaving just x of phi times the plaintext. This means that x is Damocard-Zurich's equivalent of the homomorphism psi. The exp function is easy to invert using the efficiently computable log function, which will also be important when we discuss our proposed distance function. Computing the log and dividing by phi must then give the plaintext, which proves correctness. The CP security of Damocard-Zurich cryptosystem can be reduced to the standard DCR assumption. We propose a distance function based on the efficiently computable log function in Damocard-Zurich encryption scheme. In particular, we define the distance as the log of the ciphertext C divided by the output of a function common on input C. Intuitively, we want the distance function here to capture the distance between the plaintext of C and its common point. For this to work, we need the distance function to be well-defined and for both parties to find the same common point, hence the name common point. To show it's well-defined, we need to show that C by log C is in the domain of the log function. Further, to show that the two parties end up with the same common point, we need to show that the common point for ciphertext C is the same as for the ciphertext C times X of C. Previous DTH or DCR-based HSS constructions pick common of C based on a random walk, where they have a tendency to pick some elements more often than the others. This improves the chances that both parties end up with the same common point, assuming that the points are nearby, that is, Z is small. However, the error rate that they achieve is non-negligible. The output of DISH is always incorrect whenever the two parties do not end up with the same common point. Instead, we propose to set the common function to be the modulo n operation. For this common function, we first need to show that the distance is well-defined. Log is defined for numbers of the form 1 plus nx, that is, we need its input to be 1 modulo n. That's exactly what dividing by C modulo n ensures. Furthermore, the common point for both parties will be the same since x of C is 1 modulo n, making C x of C modulo n equal to C modulo n. To state it again, our distance function is defined as follows. It's nothing but log of C divided by C modulo n. Meaning show how the proposed distance function is correct. It essentially follows from the fact that the denominators in both the log functions are the same, and furthermore log is additively homomorphic. Note that we have only shown the correctness of the distance function modulo n to the s. Our construction will in fact need to convert its output to be in integers, as it will output additive shares. These additive shares will be used by subsequent multiplications, that is, they will be used as exponents. And there is no way to consistently exponentiate to a power that is only defined modulo n to the s, because the multiplication order of the ciphertext group does not divide n to the s. Next, I'll use an example to show when using the distance function will actually give correct shares over integers and when it will not. As shown in the figure, consider the case where the two parties have shares of x as 2 and 7 respectively. Taking the difference of the shares modulo n to the s gives 7 minus 2, which is equal to 5. Hence, in this case, the shares modulo n to the s gives shares over integers as well. At the opposite end, another example is to let the two parties have shares n to the s minus 8 and n to the s minus 3 respectively. Taking the difference of the shares modulo n to the s gives n to the s minus 3 minus n to the s minus 8, which is again equal to 5. Hence, in this case too, the shares modulo n to the s gives correct shares over integers as well. However, if the two parties have shares n to the s minus 2 and 3, then taking them as shares over c gives 5 minus n to the s, which is not 5. This violates the correctness of the distance function. Note that this occurs when one of the shares wraps around n to the s while the other one doesn't. That is, the interval representing x crosses 0. More precisely, this occurs when x plus the first share of x exceeds the bound n to the s. This means that the first share of x must be close to n to the s for this error to occur. We can bound the probability of this occurrence by x by n to the s for a random share of x. When x is bounded, we can make this probability of error negligible by choosing n to the s to be sufficiently large. When the error does not occur, the modulus does not matter and the distance function will successfully output integer shares of x. Next, I'll summarize our entire HSS construction using the distance function that we just defined. To share an input x, we output Damocard Zurich encryptions of x to both evaluating parties. When evaluating the RM histogram, we get addition of memory values and multiplication by constant for free, because each memory value is essentially nothing but the additive shares of 5 times y, where y is the memory value. To multiply an input x with a memory value y, the parties exponentiate encryption of x to additive shares of y. This gives the parties multiplicative shares of x power 5xy. Applying the distance function on these multiplicative shares, the parties obtain additive shares of 5 times xy over integers with 1 minus negligible probability. And to decode a memory value z, we subtract the additive shares and then divide it by the private key phi. In this work, we introduced two new applications for our HSS construction and the proposed distance function. Firstly, we propose a two-server malicious secure ORAM with constant bandwidth below. So I'll begin by defining what's an oblivious RAM. An ORAM consists of two protocols, a setup and an access. Using a setup protocol, a client can outsource a set of data blocks, particularly n data blocks, to one or more servers. And in the access protocol, the client can input any index I and it can access the ith data block by interacting with the servers. The security requirement of ORAM essentially requires two constraints to be met. Firstly, correctness, which states that the ORAM data structure that is maintained by the servers is updated correctly after each client read and write access. Secondly, we want privacy to be maintained, that is, the client index I should be hidden from a malicious server. Our proposed ORAM construction is based on a single server onion ORAM construction. Due to lack of time, I won't have time to delve into all the details of onion ORAM and our ORAM construction. But here I'll present a high-level implementation for tree-based ORAMs, which is essentially the class of ORAMs that onion ORAM belongs to. So for tree-based ORAMs, the ORAM data structure consists of a tree where each node in the tree is a bucket. Each bucket in the tree consists of at max a fixed number of real or data blocks. And to access a specific real block, the client essentially scans one specific path which contains that data block. And after accessing, the updated data block is placed in the topmost bucket. So as to ensure that none of the buckets overflow with real data blocks, all tree-based ORAMs have what is called as an eviction algorithm, which involves percolating data blocks towards the leaves to avoid overflow. Particularly using an efficient eviction algorithm and using server-side computation, onion ORAM achieves constant communication overhead for blocks of size at least log to the power 6n. In our two-server ORAM, we essentially secret share the onion ORAM tree data structure among the two servers. Here, the secret sharing is essentially analogous to the memory values of the RMS program computation. Hence, to implement each ORAM operation, which includes setup, access, and evict, we essentially propose RMS circuits, which can be evaluated using our HSS construction. So all these ORAM operations have a select subprotocol as the key building block, which I'll focus on from now on. So essentially in this subprotocol, the server holds M additive shares of Y1 up to YN, and the client inputs an index I. And we want the protocol to output additive shares of Y sub I to the servers while hiding I from the servers. And we manage to do this select operation by just sending a single ciphertext from the client to the servers. And essentially we send an encryption of the index I. The servers can interpolate a polynomial through the points I, YI, and the servers essentially need to evaluate P of I, which would essentially output the share Y sub I. Furthermore, note that polynomial interpolation is a linear operation. Hence, we can use an RMS circuit to evaluate P of I. Specifically, to keep the bound of our RMS program small, we specifically use the Newton's polynomial interpolation method. And essentially, to evaluate Newton's polynomial interpolation method efficiently, we give an efficient RMS program, which is based on a modification of the Horner's rule. And to sort of conclude, based on this optimized select operation, we propose a two-server malicious secure ORAM based on our HSS construction, which achieves constant bandwidth lower, but for blocks of size at least log to the 4n. We next present an application of our distance function for trapdoor hash functions, or TTFs. So this is a generalization of the usual notion of TTFs to support linear functions over ring elements instead of bits. Trapdoor functions let one party generate a key pair from a linear function f, where the public key must hide the function f completely. The public and private keys can be used to compute secret shares of the output of the function, even though the key's owner is only given a hash of x. Baekeling et al. Used trapdoor hash functions to build rate 1 obligation transfer. If a single fi is set to 1 and the others are set to 0, and the second party reveals its share e at the end, the first party receives the single element xi. If public key pk is used many times, its fraction of communication goes to 0. Similarly, if h is reused for many different public keys, the fraction of communication for h goes to 0. Combining these two ideas makes the protocol have rate 1, as the communication is dominated by e, which is at the same size as the output. Using this protocol recursively, Doitling et al. Constructed an efficient PIR as well. We can construct a trapdoor hash function based on a DCR distance function. It depends on the Diffie-Hellman problem being hard modulo n squared, which follows from the DCR assumption. This requires the factors of n to be kept secret. So essentially, we need a common reference, that is Damokard-Zurich public key, where nobody knows the corresponding private key. In the public key, GI raised to power secret key is used to hide the function coefficient fi. This is roughly an Elgamal encryption of fi, where sk is the private key. The hash is the usual discrete log hash function, masked with a random value r, to make sure that the inputs are completely hidden. For correctness, first notice that if all fi's are 0, then they are doing a Diffie-Hellman key exchange to get the input to test, but with an extra group element. Four parties will end up with the same group element, so dist will essentially produce shares of 0. For non-zero fi, x of fi will get multiplied into pki. This will get exponentiated by xi, and so contribute fi into xi to the final result. Previous constructions of trapdoor hash functions from DCR have non-negligible correctness error. When f uses the ring zn to the s, we have no correctness error. For other moduli, we can use the moduli removal trick from before, which gives negligible correctness error. To conclude, we essentially construct a new HSS scheme from Damokard-Zurich encryption scheme, which gives negligible error probability and allows for exponentially large message spaces. We define a new distance function, which is based on the algebraic properties of the ciphertext group of Damokard-Zurich. And we also give new applications for our distance function and HSS construction. Specifically, we design two-server oblivious RAM scheme, and we also design a new trapdoor hash function. A few things from the paper that we couldn't cover in the presentation are, essentially we give a two-party HSS scheme to support additive decoding as well. And secondly, we extend the traditional HSS definitions to account for a few new properties of HSS schemes, which includes proving that the shares are authenticated. That is, if one of the evaluating parties was malicious, then the decode algorithm will be able to detect inconsistent shares and fail in that case. Further, we extend the definition of eval so as to not only take as input the entire program P in one go, but we also allow for gate by gate evaluations of our RMS circuit. This makes HSS suitable for online algorithms like oblivious RAMs. So in ORAM, we use both these new properties of HSS to prove our security. Thank you.